Hello and welcome to Total Health with Dr. Nick. And if you're new to my show, my purpose is very simple, and that is to inspire, empower, and motivate you to live longer, healthier, more abundant lives. And today is really all about the Keto Guide for Beginners. And I'll tell you what, guys, whether you're a beginner with keto or whether you're advanced, you're going to learn a lot of information today in this video. So I encourage you to watch it straight through the end. And in fact, if you like what we talk about, please make sure you like, you share, you comment, and more importantly, subscribe. And please make sure you hit that little bell notification so that way you're notified anytime we go on the air. So like I said, guys, this is really a complete guide to keto. So I'm going to put everything we know from all the different videos that I've done into this one, because I always hear how complicated keto is. It's so difficult. People don't even really know where to start. How do you start with keto? What's the whole beginning phases? You know, how do you measure the macros? What are the macros for that matter? How do you measure really if you're in ketosis, and really what do you eat? That's probably one of the biggest questions I get is, what do I eat on this thing? So basically I can't eat anything, huh? Is that how it works? Well, I promise you, I will answer a lot of your questions today. And like I've always said too, watch out for future videos, because we're doing a lot of recipe videos now, and I've gotten a lot of great reviews and comments about the previous ones we did. So if you haven't seen those, please check them out. Well, anyway, in my last video, I said this. I came up with the acronym that basically says KISS, right? Now, not the band, and it's not keep it simple, stupid. I would never say that. But really, very simply is this, is that keto is super simple. If you really know what to do, it becomes very simple. In fact, you can get to a point where you don't even really have to measure anything anymore, and you might not have to keep up with if you're in ketosis, because you'll just know. You'll feel a certain way. You'll be shedding pounds. You'll be losing weight, and you'll start to go to simple foods that you tend to eat a lot. Maybe you'll start to add some new ones in, but it starts to really become simple at a certain point. And I find that, you know, most people, once they're doing for a little while, it just becomes a habit. It becomes a way of life. But probably one of the biggest things I always want people to ask themselves is, why are you even starting keto? Really, what is your purpose for that? And I like to categorize it in a few different categories, and that is this. Are you doing it because you want to lose weight? Are you doing it because you just want weight loss? Well, that's a good reason, because keto is very good for that. Are you doing it because you're trying to get ready for a trip? Spring break is coming up, a cruise, maybe a high school reunion, and you want to look good. You know, you've been posting a lot of pictures online, and you're thinking, I want people to see me like that, where I've got this really trim body, not maybe the shape that you're in now, and you're trying to impress somebody or try to impress people at a reunion. So whatever it may be. Whatever the reason is, know your reason. Are you doing it because you're trying to change body composition? You're trying to lose fat, burn fat, build muscle, get that fat to body lean mass ratio right where you want it? Or are you doing it because you're trying to regulate hormones? You know, ketogenic diet is fantastic for helping to regulate hormones, because you start to add a lot more healthy fats into your diet. You start to reduce inflammation. And next thing you know, your hormones get more into balance. Or are you trying to feel better for the rest of your life? Are you using it as a lifestyle change? Do you just want to do this always? And so there's many different reasons why you want to start a ketogenic diet. And just start to search your own soul and your own consciousness for what's right for you. Why are you doing this? Because the why, what you will find is the why is always going to be the big motivator as to how you continue, or if you continue. Just to say, how am I going to do this is one thing. Why am I doing it? Is it because maybe you want to live longer? You've got children that you're concerned about, that you want to be there for them. You want to be there, and you don't want to leave them maybe early because you're getting really overweight, and you're thinking, you know what, I'm not going to last very long. If I don't get this weight off, I'm going to have children without a parent. So whatever your reason is, search your soul for it, and only you know the answer to that. Now, how can you do keto? Well, you can do keto many different ways, as far as you can make it as a lifetime thing. Like I said, you know that you need to make changes in your life, your lifestyle. You could do it for a lifetime. You could do it cyclical. I like to do it that way a lot, where I kind of go in and out of ketosis. And that's perfectly fine too. So that way you can enjoy maybe the things that you want to enjoy that you know aren't on a ketogenic diet. And you can enjoy those from time to time. I call them my treat days, not my cheat days, because I'm not cheating. I'm choosing to do it. And a lot of times I'm, you know, switching back and forth between keto and paleo. Paleo maybe is a little less restrictive. You can get some more things into your diet that you normally would like to eat, but you can't have it so much on the keto. So you go back and forth. Maybe you want to call it ketio. I don't know. You can decide. Or I like to do the 80-20 principle where about, you know, 80% of the time I'm eating right, 90% of the time I eat great. And you know what, that 20% of the time I stray a little bit. You know, I'll tell you, I'm all about honesty. The other day, my wife and I wanted to try a new restaurant in our area, and it was a pizza place. I had some pizza, yes, it was okay. And you know what, it was a one day thing, and then I'm right back into what I should be eating. So guys, don't feel bad about it if you have a treat day. Treat days are okay. Don't beat yourself up about it. Don't feel like you fell off the wagon. I get that a lot. Patients will, or people, viewers will comment, and they'll say, you know what, I got away from ketogenic diet for you know, 2 weeks, 2 months, whatever it may be, and I don't know how to get started back on it. I'm a little scared about getting started back on it. And my answer always is jump right back in. Just jump in. And then the comments I get are, you were right. Thank you so much for inspiring me and motivating me to do that. So you jump right back into it. So whatever the reason may be, you can change it up. You don't have to feel like, well, I have to do keto all my life. If I choose to do it, I have to. No, you don't have to. You can make it lifetime. You can make it where you go in and out of it cyclically. You can make it so it's an 80-20 principle. Whatever you want to do, it's really up to you. Whatever your goals are is why you're going to choose to do this and how long you're going to choose to do it. Now, how do you measure ketosis? How do you know if you're in it? Well, you have to really kind of take measurements. And a lot of times I'll have people say, you know what, I've never measured it. Well, that's okay. You don't have to measure it. But if you really want to know accurately if you're in ketosis, because sometimes I will get questions where people say, hey, ketogenic diet doesn't work. It didn't work for me. Well, were you even in it? Do you even know if you were in it? You don't know because you never took a measurement. So really the first thing we typically look at is people will pee on those little chem strips, and those chem strips are measuring for acetoacetate. So the first thing your body's gonna start to excrete when you get into ketosis is in through the urine, and it's gonna be acetoacetate. After a little while, about 2 weeks, you're not gonna be able to use that as a measurement anymore. So those little chem strips are gonna become inaccurate. But you could also measure through your breath. In your breath, you have acetone. So acetone is that sweet taste that you get when you exhale. And a lot of times people use something called ketonics. Now, ketonics is a breath ketone analyzer, and it's good too. But here's the problem I see with ketonics, is that unless you're exhaling the same amount each time or the same amount of force, it might not be as accurate. By far, the most accurate way that I measure is when I use a blood glucose meter and a ketone meter. So this one is made by Keto Mojo. It happens to be very good. I'll put the link below if you choose to go on and order from them. But Keto Mojo is fantastic because one thing I find is that those keto strips, the little strips that you put in the meter, once you prick your finger, and it's very easy. People are worried about pricking their finger, and it's very simple. All you do is take the lancet, put it in a low setting, and push the button, and you don't even feel it. And then you get that little droplet of blood. You put it on the tip of the strip that sticks out of here, and it's very simple. You just measure it, and it gives you a reading in about 10 seconds. So what you want to do is you want to order it, as I said, from Keto Mojo, simply because anywhere else you try to find these ketone strips, they can be very expensive. They can be upwards of $3 a strip, so $3 a test if you really think about it. So Keto Mojo sells them for about 99 cents. So it's the best deal in town easily, so I highly recommend using them. And with that, you're measuring your beta hydroxy butyrate. So that's what's being measured, and that's by far the most accurate. Now, the next thing you want to do is you want to get some apps. And with the apps, you want to be able to measure. People will always say to me in their questions, how do I measure these things? How do I know how much protein to take? How do I know what my calories are? How do I know what my macros are, right? Macros are your proteins, carbs, and fats. How do I know how to measure those? How do I know how much I've eaten during the course of the day? It's very simple. Just put it all in the apps. You got these apps in your phone. It's so simple today. I use MyPlate app. Many of you have heard me talk about that before. You just simply put in your measurements as far as, you know, what you weigh now, what you want to weigh, and you say, you know what, I want to weigh this by this point. It calculates it out. It says, okay, if you want to weigh X amount within 3 months, maybe you have a trip coming up, it tells you what your calories need to be. From there, you plug in your other numbers, and it's so super simple that you can easily see what you need to be eating on a daily basis, and as you put the foods in, it calculates it all the way through, and I'm going to show you that in just a moment. A lot of people who can't get MyPlate for some reason will say, MyFitnessPal works for them too, and that's another great one. And there's a ton of calorie counters out there that you can put in your phone and be able to measure this. So it's really, really not difficult, guys. Just use the apps. It does all the work for you, okay? Next, what are macros? How do you calculate them? And like I said, your macros are just simply your big food groups, okay? Your proteins, fats, and carbs. Your micros, those are your vitamins and minerals. So your macros are the bigger ones. These are the ones you measure on a regular basis. And in a ketogenic diet, you want to be in a certain range. Unlike paleo, paleo doesn't look at macro at all. Keto does. Keto, you want to be in certain percentages. So, for example, your fats should be about 70%. Now, is it a problem if your fats are 60% one day or 65%? No, don't stress about it. Don't worry about it. If it's in the 70% range, it's great. And once again, the apps will calculate this for you. You don't have to sit here and figure out on a calculator what you're eating each day. You want your proteins to be in the range of about 25%, and you want your carbs at about 5. Now, I will hear people say to me that the ketogenic diet is no carb diet. Guys, that's impossible. Everything is going to have some carbs in it, even vegetables. If you have asparagus, if you have broccoli, cauliflower, there's going to be some carbs in that. So it's not a no-carb diet, it's just a low-carb diet, about as low as you can get, so that way your body has to flip to where it burns fat for fuel rather than sugars. And that's really the big difference between a ketogenic diet and so many other diets, is how it has the ability to get you what we call keto or fat adapted, to where your body prefers as a fuel source burning fats rather than carbohydrates. So once again, here's your percentages. Now I'm going to give you an example about mine. Now here's me. When I look at what I want to weigh and I look at the range I want to stay in, I need to consume about 1,700 calories a day, roughly. Now, do I eat more than that some days? Sure I do. I mean, the day I had pizza, I'm sure I was well out of that range. And then all I do is reel it in or dial it in the next day. It's no big deal. You know, people look at it on a daily basis that I have to have a certain amount of calories and so on, and certain amount of grams of fat and protein. You know, your body doesn't measure things day to day. It just is a simple tool to be able to do it that way, but don't beat yourself up if you go out of that range that day. Make it up the next day. It's no big deal. Don't beat yourself up about it. The worst thing you do is beat yourself up and say, you know what, I fell off the wagon, I can't do keto, I can't do any diet, I'm a loser, I'm terrible at this. Don't worry about it. It's okay. Just start the next day. Just start the next day. That's all you need to do. And by the way, if you made New Year's resolutions and you know what, we're into January right now and you've already blown it, don't worry about it. January 1st is just a number. How many people do that? They start the New Year's resolution and they go, well, you know what? It's on the weekend, so I don't know if I could really start on the 1st. I'll start on the 3rd because the 3rd is a Monday. Guys, it's just a date. Just pick any date and start. It could be March 3rd. That's the day you start eating right and doing a diet. Don't beat yourself up. It's okay. Anyway, so here's my numbers. Back to me over here. Here's my numbers. Total calories, 718. Typically on a ketogenic diet, you want to be under 50 grams of carbs a day. Now, in your first week, you may want to start at 10. Then you may want to start at 20 your second week, and 30, 40, and 50, so on for subsequent weeks. But by definition, you really want to be under 50 grams of carbs. Now, for some of you, that is a dramatic drop, and that's going to help you burn calories right there. Grams of protein, I need about 90. Okay, now that works for me because I exercise, I work out with weights. It's going to be different from you and I'll show you in a moment how to calculate that. You're probably wondering why I've got a question mark next to fats. Because fats, once I know the other numbers, once I know where I am in calories and I know where I am in carbs and protein, I just sprinkle the fats in. The fats just get added in. So that's why I'm saying keto is super simple. Once you know your other numbers, you just add fat. And you look at the end of the day and see how you turned out. Or as you're measuring your day as you go along, you can start to see. And like I said, I'm going to show you that in just a moment. Now, how you figure out your numbers, once again, is based on your lean body mass. Now, how do you calculate lean body mass? Well, first of all, you have to know about how much fat you've got. Now, some of you may have sophisticated equipment like we do in our office, where we put our patients on something called a Tanita machine, where it puts a little bit of a mild current through the body. The patients are standing on a plate, and it measures your fat percentage extremely accurately. Some of you, and I don't know if you do this, you can get immersed in a tank, and that's about the most accurate way to do it. And some of you just use a caliper. Okay? If you don't have any of that, don't worry. It's no big deal. All you have to do is go online and Google fat percentage chart. And you can find it just like this. This is very simple. So for males, here we are, 4 to 5%, you're pretty ripped. Ladies, you're going to be different. 6 to 7%, you've got abs over here. 8 to 10%, you're looking like this. And you look at where you are and you figure it out and you say, you know what? I must be, in my case, I'm around the 11 to 12% range. Okay, that's just where I play into this. Some of you might be at the 20 to 30 or 25 to 30% range. Some of you may be ripped already. So either way, you figure out your fat percentage. Ladies, you're going to be a little bit different. Ladies, even though you're ripped like this guy here, you're going to be a different percentage. So over here, a lady that's the same equivalency of a guy who's 4 to 5%, you're going to be about 12 to 14%. Ladies carry just innately a little bit more fat on their bodies, probably because it has a lot to do with childbearing, okay? So anyway, you look at your percentage and you figure it out. So if you're a certain percentage, you're then going to multiply that times your total body weight to find your lean body weight, or what we call your fat-free mass. So what that looks like is this. Once again, here's me. Just for illustration purposes, 1,718 calories, less than 50 grams of carbs a day, and I want to be about 89 to 90 grams of protein a day. Now, over here, this is how you get the calculation. Because one of the biggest questions I get all the time is, how do I calculate my protein? This is how you do it. I'm going to show you right now. It's going to be very simple. So, in my case, I weigh 168 pounds. Now, I fluctuate here and there. One day I might be 170, another day I might be 166. So, I'm about 168 pounds. I'm about 11% body fat. Okay. What I then do is take the 168, multiply it. Now, you can multiply it times 0.11 for the 11, and you can reverse that, and then you come out with the actual percent. Or you can multiply it times 89 and just figure out the percent. So it's 149 pounds of lean body mass. Okay, so once again, you take your total, multiply it times your fat, and then you get your percent of lean body mass. Now, with that number, now I multiply it again to figure out how much protein I need per day. Now, if you're a bodybuilder and you are competing, you're going to need more protein. Even though the ketogenic diet is very protein sparing and very muscle sparing, you want to make sure you're getting adequate amounts of protein because you're an extreme athlete. You're putting more on. Now, and if you are an extreme athlete doing a lot of different, you know, extreme sports, you might need more protein also. You might need a gram per pound of lean body weight. Or you might go a little higher. You might go 1.6 or 1.5, whatever it may be. For me, it's about 0.6 grams because I work out, but I'm not trying to compete. I'm not doing what I did years ago. I'm just trying to stay in shape because I'm in practice, I have a family, and I just want to stay in shape. So I take 0.6 grams and I multiply it times my lean body weight or fat-free mass. So here's the 0.6 and I multiply it times the 149 that I got here, and this gives me the total, about 90 grams of protein, give or take a gram. So that's how I know how much protein I need per day. So guys, if you need to just go over this chart over and over again so you can figure out your lean body mass or your fat-free mass, and then from there calculate your protein, once you've got that number, you're done. You don't really have to continue to figure it out unless you're putting on a lot of muscle and now all of a sudden you need to figure out a new fat-free mass because maybe your fat-free mass is now up to 152 or 168, and you know it just keeps going up because you're putting on more and more muscle. But other than that, you really don't have to keep recalculating this. And ladies, you're going to be less. If you're not working out so much and you don't have as much muscle mass that you're trying to put on, this number here could be 0.4 or 0.3. You might not need as much protein in a day. For me, once again, it's 0.6. But for you, it may be 0.3, 4, or 5. And that's okay. You multiply it out. Now, what it looks like in daily totals for me now is this. And this is, of course, going to be different for you. So here on this one day, and the thing is about the MyPlate app is it calculates it at the end of the day. So I could take my numbers and see them all at the end of the day and see exactly how the whole day looked in a shot, in a glance. And it puts it on a nice wheel so I could see how much protein I had, how much fat, and how many carbs I had. So on this particular day, I was 67% fat, which is about where I want to be, 65 to 70. My protein was at 22%. That was very good too. I want to be, you know, 20 to 25%. Carbs were 11%. So now I want to keep that normally down at 5. So it wasn't a catastrophe. It was no big deal. It was a little higher for that day, but that's no big deal. It's not going to change things for the worse because I'm still way under what I normally would have eaten if I wasn't doing a ketogenic diet. So here's the total. I had 1,900 calories that day. I worked out. And a lot of you thinking your workouts are probably burning tons and tons of calories. I will tell you this. You will never work off at the gym a bad diet. You can't do it. You think you're at the gym for an hour, I'm burning, you know, 1,200 calories. You're not. You're burning a few hundred, maybe 400 or 500. So you need to look at whatever you're about to eat and say to yourself, okay, how much working out is it going to need for me to burn off that piece of whatever? And just ask yourself that question. You know, you're going to be shocked. So anyway, I burned 262 calories. I worked out about a half an hour, 40 minutes. Calories net were 1681. Like I said, I'm right in the range of where I wanted to be. This is what it all looked like. I can look over here and see protein was about 112 grams. I was a little higher that day. No big deal. But I could see exactly where I wanted to be. My carbs. Now, this is a question I always get about carbs. So carbs, you could have total carbs and you have net carbs. What does that mean? Well, very simple. In fact, I did a video on this called What the Bleep Are Carbs Anyway, so you can watch that one. I'll probably put that link down below. In fact, I'll have a lot of links of other videos I've done down below in the description. But anyway, what net carbs is this? You take total carbs, and then a lot of times you see dietary fiber right under carbs. Well, dietary fiber is undigestible, so you have to take it out. So if you have, for example, 20 grams of carbs a day in one meal or in one type of food, but there's net 50, there's 15 grams of dietary fiber, well, you subtract that 15 from the 20, and next thing you know, you're at 5 net grams of carbs. So once again, you take your total carbs, subtract out the dietary fiber, and that gives you your net carbs. So over here, there was 55 grams of carbs for the day, total carbs. I subtract out the 24 dietary fiber, and that puts me right in the 20 range. 21, 22, 23, and I'm perfect. Now, what about the sugars? It has sugars over here too. Sugar's already calculated into the total carbs. You don't need to worry about that, so don't add that in. It's already calculated in. All right, so let's get into some of the foods now, because one of the big questions I always get is, what do I eat on this diet? Is it, can I eat anything? I have sometimes people write to me and they'll get frustrated and say, so basically I can't eat anything on this diet. No, no, you guys can eat a ton of stuff. I mean, more than you'll ever imagine. In fact, because there's so much fat in the diet, you'll always feel satiated. So, grass-fed beef, buffalo, venison, lamb, you know, all the different meats, chicken, turkey, duck, you could have all of that. Now, a lot of times people will say to me, but wait a minute, you know, this sounds like a diet for people who are wealthy. I can't get grass-fed this, and I can't get organic that. I don't have that kind of money. What about a, you know, keto for a, on a budget? I'll tell you this. You don't have to have grass-fed. I'm just giving you what's optimal. You don't have to have grass-fed. You don't have to have, you know, the purest organic food. Just by changing to this type of diet to where you're eating more fats for fuel, moderate protein, and very low carbs, you're going to burn fat. It doesn't have to be where everything is organic and top of the line. Just changing to this is going to be okay. So you don't have to worry if you can't afford that. That's all right. But anyway, so optimally, if you can get grass-fed, it's good. So over here, non-processed or the processed meats, well, what can you have? Well, you can have, for example, turkey bacon. I don't recommend pork. Pork is typically an animal that has a lot of toxins in its meat and a lot of toxins in its fat, even though it's cleaner now than it was in biblical times. It's just a simple fact that pork's not a really great food. But, you know, sausage, deli meats, and so on, organic grass-fed, Applegate, Naturals is really good. I like that brand a lot. You can find a lot of things. One time a patient said to me, you know what, Dr. Nick, you have hot dogs on there? What's with the hot dogs? Applegate makes a really good hot dog that's uncured beef. It's really, really good, so you can have that. Anyway, dairy, grass-fed cheese, whole milk, heavy cream, ghee butter, Greek yogurt, all these things. Now, one of the things I want to say about this, and people ask me all the time, why are you, I'm not against dairy, but you know, why are you, you know, downing it so much? My problem with dairy is this, it can be very inflammatory. All I'm going to say is this, if you want to add it in and have some dairy in it, that's okay. My problem is when people are eating cheese all day and bacon. That's what I call a dirty keto diet. You don't want that. If you want some bacon on occasion, if you want some cheese, that's fine. You can have it. Just don't have it all the time to where you're eating a very dirty kind of keto diet, where you're just living on a few different food groups and they're not even great quality. You want healthy quality fats that we're going to get into in just a moment. sardines, flounder, tuna. Now here's all your fish, your cod, your snapper, your herring. Okay, so fish is fantastic. Eat lots of fish. And I had a patient one time, and actually a viewer one time also say to me, well, should I eat just more fatty meats? Well, here's a problem I have with that. When you're just eating more fatty meats, you really can't measure how much fat you're getting with that, because you can't measure it. You're not going to cut the fat out separately and weigh it and measure it. But what you do is you could take regular lean cuts of meat and add fat to it. Take fish and add fat to it. Put butter on it. Put ghee. Put olive oil. Put avocado oil. Whatever you want, you can add these different fats to it. And the cool thing is you could actually measure the fat. So if you put a tablespoon of fat on your steak once you're done cooking it, you measure that. You know exactly how much you put rather than having a fattier cut of meat. So shark, mackerel, tuna, mahi-mahi, things like that. I know people are worried about mercury. I'm honestly more worried about the mercury that's in your fillings than in these fish. You know, people just have so much more mercury in their teeth. But if you're concerned about it, eat smaller fish. That's all you need to do. If you want salmon, have sockeye salmon, because it has no teeth, or little tiny ones. It doesn't eat, it basically eats vegetation and smaller little type of fish. So anyway, lobster, crab, mussels, not a big fan of the shellfish, but you know what? They're really tasty. So if you want to eat them, go ahead and eat them. Fats. Here you are. Here's the big one, fats. So what kind of fats can you eat? Animal fats. I know you're all concerned. Well, wait, Dr. Nick, people have said don't eat saturated fats. Animal fats are bad. Go back and watch my video on saturated fats. It's fantastic. You'll learn a lot about really what saturated fats are all about and how necessary they are for the body. And by the way, your brain is made of about, you know, 60% fat, so you need fat in your diet, especially cholesterol. Brain is made of cholesterol a lot. Anyway, beef tallow, that's basically beef fat. Avocado, coconut milk, coconut butter, coconut oil, anything coconut's good. One of my favorite go-to snacks lately is just coconut butter. I just take the jar of it and just eat it with a spoon. It's fantastic. Coconut flakes. Once again, your ghee, your grass-fed butter, extra virgin olive oil, avocado oil, like I said, walnut oil, macadamia oil, MCT oil. MCT oil, for a lot of you who are wondering about that, I have a video on that too. But MCT oil is really the best part of the coconut oil. So when you look at the different chain fats that are in coconut oil, the longer chains, they range anywhere from 6 to 12 carbons. Coconut oil is really the smaller chains, the medium chain triglycerides, the smaller ones, which are much easily absorbable and gets into your system a lot better. Grass-fed cheese, once again, we're back to the fats again here that we talked about earlier with the dairy. Vegetables, I mean, you could just eat just about anything with this. You just want to stay away from the high starchy vegetables. Other than that, everything is amazing. Asparagus, bok choy, cabbage, cauliflower, broccoli. I mean, everything is fair game here. Celery, eggplant. You know, any kind of the greens are going to be good. A lot of people look at kale and they think, well, it's just a garnish, or maybe I'll juice it so I don't have to taste it. But if you take something like lacinato kale and slice the rib out of the middle of it, the stem part, and then just chop it up into small pieces, put it in a pan with some olive oil or some butter, salt, pepper, some garlic, oh my gosh. It's like spinach on steroids. It's so delicious, so good. Or you could chop it up and put it in a salad. Really, really great. But lacinato kale is fantastic. You get all the high ANDI score vegetables. ANDI score means aggregate nutrient density index, though the highest scoring vegetables are, and kale's a rock star. Just start adding that. It literally tastes like spinach with a little more bite to it, a little bit more, you know, al dente. So sprouts, watercress, zucchini, kale, anything you want. All good. Fermented vegetables. I love fermented vegetables. I love kimchi. I made some just the other day. I made like 7 quart-sized containers of it. Sauerkraut, kombucha, kimchi, coconut kefir, amasi. Any of your fermented vegetables, all great for you, because one, you're getting the prebiotic, which nobody ever talks about, which is the actual food. So the cabbage, the bok choy, Brussels sprouts, if you put it in it, those are the prebiotic. That's got all the fiber. And then the probiotic is, of course, the bacteria that's breaking that down. Fantastically healthy for your gut. Pickles, kimchi, fermented whey, apple cider vinegar, did a video on that too. This is all good stuff. Fruit. What fruits are good? Well, typically the fruits that are good are your ones that are your antioxidant-rich fruits. You know, basically your low glycemic index fruits, like your berries. Berries are always going to be a great choice there. So your raspberries, blueberries. Now, if you have to have an apple, go for the Granny Smith. It's more tart, less sweet. It's going to be a lot better for you. Lemons and limes are fantastic. In fact, lemons are very alkaline for the body. So even though you're looking at this going, well, lemon's going to be very acidic for me. No, no, no. When it goes in your body, it's very alkaline, very cleansing, high in electrolytes. So it's very, very good. Strawberries, grapefruit, kiwi. Raspberries and tomatoes. Now, nuts and seeds. Okay, so nuts and seeds are great snacks, but you don't want to eat a ton of them. Okay, but they're very, very good. Your macadamia nuts are probably the best. Hazelnuts, walnuts, very high in omega-3 fats, so it's very anti-inflammatory. Some of the seeds are good. Chia seeds, almond butter. Of course, coconut butter, like I said earlier, is one of my favorite little go-to snacks lately. I'm going to make in some snack foods in some of my upcoming videos, so watch out for that. Pistachio, pumpkin seeds, walnut, sesame, of course, and coconut itself, whether it be shredded or coconut flakes, just a great snack. Other, all right, some sweeteners. So you can use some sweeteners. Things like xylitol, stevia, and erythritol are great sweeteners. You don't want to use things like agave, but agave is so natural. No, but it's also extremely high glycemic, so you don't want to use that. Even things that are natural like your coconut sugar. Coconut sugar is good, but it's not good on keto because of the fact that it's just got a higher glycemic index than you really want. Even though it's lower than regular table sugar, it's still going to be higher than where you want to be, so I don't recommend that one. But cocoa powder is fantastic. Almond flour, coconut flour. These are a lot of the flours you can use in cooking. So I highly recommend these. Coconut, because of the fact that it tends to dry things out, you want to make sure you add a little more liquid to it or reduce the amount of coconut flour. You could add almond flour to it to kind of, you know, offset it a little bit. Mayonnaise is great. Vinegar, of course, is great. Apple cider. Different things you can drink. Water, of course, is always going to be good. Black tea, green tea, coffee is fine. I love having coffee. In fact, I do it with the butter and the coconut oil or the MCT oil, so bulletproof coffee or butter coffee, whatever you want to call it. Coconut milk, fantastic, and smoothies. A lot of times I drink a smoothie if I just got back from the gym and I don't have time to really make a lunch before I have to get back to my office. And so what I'll do is I'll take some berries, put it in a container or in my Vitamix, put in some coconut milk, some almond milk, add the protein powder, add some collagen powder also, blend it up and take it, and I'm out the door. So it's really, really fast. So I drink a lot of coconut milk here. Now, why I've got bone broth highlighted in yellow here is very simple, because bone broth, you can almost say it's a superfood. It's just fantastic. One of the things you're going to notice when you're on a ketogenic diet is you need to make sure you replenish your electrolytes. So one of the ways to do that is with bone broth. It's such a fantastic way. I like to take bone broth and just basically put it in a cup or a big mug. Then, so I use it to measure. I pour it into the pot, and then I start heating it up, and I add some salt, some pepper. I add some avocado oil or olive oil, and maybe a little bit of apple cider vinegar, and I actually make like a little soup out of it, like a cup of soup. So you're getting all the electrolytes. The salt you're putting in is the Himalayan sea salt or the Celtic salt, or even just Mediterranean sea salt, whatever you want to use. Either way, it's going to work out, but you've got to keep your electrolytes up because your body will start to lose water. Now, a lot of you are excited about that, thinking, oh my gosh, I'm going to lose weight, but it's really a lot of water weight, because when you don't take in the carbs, your carbs are what helps your body retain water. So by losing the carbs, your body's losing about 4 grams of water per gram of carbs. So you really don't want to do that. So you want to eat and drink things that are electrolyte rich. So bone broth is going to be a great one. Otherwise, put some salt in your water. One of the things I like to do a lot is put some water with some apple cider vinegar and then add to that some sea salt or the Himalayan salt. Mix that up, and that's just a great, refreshing, quick drink. So anyway, the last thing I want to talk about is keto flu. You've all heard about it, and you're all probably worried about it. I don't want the flu. I don't want to ache. I don't want to hurt. But the keto flu is not really the flu. It's not like you need to go get a shot for it or anything like that. So very simply, collection of symptoms associated with the body adapting to a higher fat, lower carb diet. That's really all it is. But the symptoms can be many. They could be things like anything from brain fog or lack of concentration, achy joints, achy muscles, things like that. So it tends to feel like the flu, fatigue, lethargy, however you like to pronounce it. So you just don't have the energy, you feel weak. So it, once again, it's going to feel like the flu. Nausea, dizziness, constipation, once again, you want to beat that by drinking a lot more liquids, a lot more water, maybe like I said, the bone broth, or just having water a lot more. So these are a list of the symptoms that you can see with the keto diet. Now, here's the thing though, guys. It goes away in about a week. So it's not like you're going to suffer with this for too long. As your body's adapting and changing, it's kicking and screaming, having a temper tantrum like a little toddler that it doesn't want to change. I'm not calling you toddlers. That it doesn't want to change from sugar to fats. But fat is the preferred fuel source. So once you make the change, once you make that flip, that switch, all of this is going to go away and you're going to feel fantastic. You're going to have more energy. You're going to have more mental clarity. And the cool thing too is your brain starts to change how it starts to work. Your body burns off a lot of the bad cells that it had. That's called autophagy, where your body attacks and gets rid of old worn out cells. So your body flips a switch. You have less inflammation in your body. So overall, you're going to love this. So switch over to this. So guys, I hope this was a good guide. Once again, it was a guide for beginners, but I think a lot of people who are advanced can benefit from this too. So if you know someone who can really use this information, then please make sure you like, you share, you comment, you subscribe. And like I said, guys, keto is super simple. So you can do it. Your friends can do it. Get people involved. Get other people that, you know, maybe can hold you accountable doing it too. That's one of the best ways to do this. So like I said, guys, thanks so much for being with me today. I hope this information was good. Watch for our upcoming videos. We're going to be doing a lot more cooking videos. But like I said, please like, share, comment, and subscribe. God bless. This is Dr. Nick. I'll see you soon. Bye-bye.